Today also we have a discussion on the contraction of high eccentricity satellite orbits with air drag in terms of chaos regular elements. Last time we had discussed on it, because these high eccentricity orbits are quite useful. Even then, their orbit is to be determined with respect to a different set of forces, but drag plays a very important role, and their decay is mainly controlled by atmospheric drag and the gravity of the sun and the moon. Sun and moon also does a little bit, but sun does the maximum contribution there. We'll have that kind of one lecture later. So today I have taken one paper I was looking into, a report from observations, university departments and research establishment. This is Royal Aircraft Establishment, where Professor King Ali and a large group was working, and they were contributing very immensely. And this was probably the last report, because they say that next year their department was revamped. So let us see. In 1986, the Space Department of RAE was, Royal Aircraft Establishment, was chiefly concerned with research and development in space technology and remote sensing. But the research program included work on improving knowledge on the Earth's gravitational field and upper atmosphere by analysis of satellite orbits. Computer programs developed at RAE are used to determine orbits, because they need very accurate orbits from optical and radar observations, and the orbital changes are analyzed for their geophysical implications. From there only they find out, you know, see, we have a fairly good model, Earth gravity model for Earth. So all these people have, you know, contributed to this. These groups have contributed immensely. Various groups working throughout the world, they have contributed, and now today we are very comfortable in a gravity model. For example, still for moon, we are struggling. That moon gravity model is not very comfortable. RAE has given financial support to the UK facility for the precise tracking of satellites, which is responsible for the operation of the satellite laser ranger at the Royal Greenwich Observatory. The two AVID cameras and the satellite prediction service, they have those services over there. Early in 87, there were administrative changes in the Space Department to prepare for the expected establishment of the British National Space Center. And it is probable that this will be the last report in the present form. Because I was just going through, then I found that this will be useful, because we can learn something from this report, some of the things which they have discussed, so that it will be of use to us. So some of the works they carried out during that year, they have discussed, and you see how much important jobs they carried out. Orbital theory. I told that Professor Gooding, he was also a very important, he was excellent in orbit determination. Because orbit determination is another thing, but at the same time, he contributed on analytical studies as well. Has completed his preliminary study on a new approach to semi-analytical orbit modeling based on Kovel integration. Kovel's method, you know, is any kind of forces you can take and you can integrate. Yes. And results were presented at the 1986 COSPAR meeting in Toulouse. The promise of the method is currently marred by some small, maybe at that time when they returned, small unexplained anomalies. There might have come some anomalies. The work of A.W. O'Dell and R.H. Gooding on Kepler's equation. This is another important, you know, where almost all great mathematicians have put their minds to solve this equation, Kepler's equation. m is equal to e minus e sin e. M is the eccentric anomaly, m is the mean anomaly, e is the eccentric anomaly, and e small e is the eccentricity. Kepler's equation has been published, and R.H. Gooding has extended the methodology to the hyperbolic Kepler's equation also. With accurate, I think they were published in Celestial Mechanics Journal. With accurate and efficient algorithms available for both equations, R.H. Gooding has developed new universal procedures for unperturbed orbits, which connect from orbital elements to position and velocity and vice versa. See, when I needed a program to compute the oscillating elements to mean elements and mean to oscillating. And then I was looking for theories. So I found out the theory of Chevrotarev for this, because we were working mostly on circular orbits. And then Dr. Bhatnagar and Dr. Takvi, which they extended to second order. So those expressions, then I asked, requested Dr. Takvi that you have a check, because we have to use this program, your expressions. So he checked and he found that there is no, he said they are all okay. The printings are quite fine. So we programmed them, and like that, one or two more algorithms I located. And then we developed a program to convert oscillating to mean and mean to oscillating. And that time, iteration scheme was required, and this Gooding's scheme, a wonderful paper he wrote, that was I used that his method to convert them, because we have to convert sometimes oscillating orbital elements to mean elements and mean orbital elements to oscillating elements. King Haley and Walker have developed an improved theory for determination of changes in satellite orbits. This theory, this also he pushed. King Haley put in his book also, when in 1987, when he published his important book, second book on this area, caused by meridional winds. You see, there are two types of winds, zonal winds and meridional winds, which are going from, you know, in the horizontal direction, and then some are in the vertical, from going from south to north, and these are going from west to east. They are going. So these play important role in changing the orbital inclination, and it can change the small omega as well, capital omega also, because capital omega, small omega, these are all are affected by them. So this theory they developed, and this is one I wanted to convert this into KS theory, but somehow I put a couple of times my mind, but I was not able to do at that time. And later on, we were busy here and there, and so this got left. The previous theory was expressed in terms of the equivalent angular rotation phi, capital phi. And the new theory is in terms of m is equal to phi secant, small phi, where phi is the latitude. It is shown that in practice, m is just as useful as a controlling parameter, this m. And the result in terms of m are much simpler and more accurate. The results apply to an orbit of any eccentricity. So this is closed form, 0 to 1 in an oblate atmosphere. They utilized oblate atmosphere, because oblate atmosphere plays a very important role. That's how we learned from his book and his and other papers also. King Haley and Walker have developed an orbital theory for assessing the effect of satellite lifetimes of atmospheric oblateness and of oscillation of perigee distance caused by the odd zonal harmonics. There we have even and odd both in the zero potential. So the perigee oscillation, that also affects the orbital lifetime. The results are valid for the great majority of orbits about the Earth, and in particular for all orbital eccentricities between 0 and 1. But the limit of controlling parameter lead to the exclusion of near polar orbits. When I is 90 degrees, those things are with the perigee height lower than 180 degrees. When it's very lower than 180, and those are not studied. And orbits having inclination within a narrow band of. See, near critical inclination, we have a problem. at 63.4 degrees, because there you have a very special problem. Maybe this also we will sometime discuss at length, because this is a physical singularity there. The effects of are expressed in the form of factors FAO and FOZ, of which the lifetime leads to be multiplied. Either factor can change the lifetime by an amount of 35%, and take together they can produce changes up to 60% for particular values of the initial and final position of perigee for eccentricity greater than 0.2. So perigee plays a very important role. Determination orbit from observations. See, this is a very important study which that group used to make. The orbit most likely to be valuable for research on the Earth's gravitational field, because that's continuously was being monitored and being improved. Or upper atmosphere also, how the physics of the upper atmosphere to be understood properly. So these studies were very useful. Are selected for priority in observation and orbit determination. A priority list of such satellites is updated every 3 months. So they were finding out, you know, they were studying, they were prioritizing the satellite or whose orbits they need to study by the optical tracking subcommittee of the British National Committee on Space Research. The suitability of the satellites for optical observations is a prime factor in the choice made. So this was one of the prime factor for the choice of the satellites made. The satellite prediction service at the University of Aston provides prediction for the listed satellites, which are then observed by the volunteer visual observers around the world and by the University of Aston's two Hewitt cameras, which are situated at the Royal Greenwich Observatory, Hermon's, and at Sling Spring Observatory in Australia. The US Navy also kindly supplied observation from the NACSPASU system. Up to 100 observations of these three types, of which the Hewitt cameras are by far the most accurate, are used with any other observations that may be available for determining the orbits with the RAE. They have developed a very accurate orbit prediction determination program, RAE Prop 6, orbit refinement program. They call it orbit refinement program, over a time interval usually between 1 and 10 days. 4 orbit determinations are in progress, were progress at that time maybe, have been completed during the year. MR SOTI and AN Winterbottom have determined the orbit of Cosmos 1335-198207A, a circular orbit at 74 degree inclination. It was a circular orbit at 74 degree between September 1985 to May 1986, when the orbit was experiencing the effect of 31:3 resonance. The meaning of 31:3 resonance is, in 2 days, the satellite is taking 31 revolutions. In 2 days, it is taking. So these will have, these orbits will have, because in 2 days, it takes 31 revolutions. So it will repeat this kind of scenario. Orbits were determined at 26 epoch from 1398 observations, including 46 observations from the two Hewitt cameras, which much improved orbital accuracy. An average accuracy of about 120 meter cross track and 100 meter radial was achieved. See, those days, that was the thing. In 1987, they are talking 80s before that. So was achieved with an improvement by a factor of about 2 when Hewitt camera observations were available. So this camera was helping them. The variations in inclination and eccentricity have been analyzed to determine 31st order harmonics in the geopotential. Because this, why they have studied this 31:2 is because 31 harmonics in the geopotential they wanted to, because those have to be, you know, gradually they have to be updated. Their values have to be, they are all numerically, they are computed values. It's a very complicated program, very complicated studies to evolve the gravity of the Earth. Very complicated. D.G. King Haley has determined 37 orbits for Pegasus 1, 1965-09A, from 2064 observations. So 2064 observations between November 76 to September 74, at a time when 15th order resonance. So 15th means 15 revolution it is taking satellite, it is passing through that, were likely to have their maximum resonant effect on the eccentricity. So eccentricity doesn't behave normally at that time. See, because what happens is when satellite takes 15 revolutions per day, so it will take again, you know, after 15 day again it will see the same place. Now supposing it sees the mountains, so it will see the mountains at that time, the decay, the gravity field will be different. So the satellite will experience different gravity field over when it passes over that mountains, or it is passing through some valleys, or over Himalayas, or like that. So this is how that 15th order, to improve upon those with the help of the satellite. So it says, see the gravity, what we talk about these numbers, these are all come after a lot of efforts by lot of groups. Very difficult task. Improving the determination of even degree, even and odd degrees are there, even degree, 15th order geopotential coefficients. The accuracy achieved was equivalent to 80 meter cross track and 120 meter radial. In radial direction, when you're radial means your guy going in the direction radial, and then a perpendicular to that is cross track. But still, you know, this much they were able to achieve. But with time, you know, the as things go and people work on more, so these numbers must have improved, because I'm talking of that time, what these people are telling at that time. So DMC Walker, another strong companion of King Haley right from the beginning, had determined 74 orbits of Cosmos 220 rocket 196840B at the time of its 29 and 2 is to 2. That means 29 orbits it is taking in 2 days. Resonance with the Earth's gravitational field between January 1983 to July 1985. Observations from both the UVIT cameras were successfully used, about 100 plates being available for 38 of the orbits. A.N. Winterbottom had determined 40 orbits of Cosmos 236. 196870 at the time of its 15th order resonance. So it was passing through 15th order. See, there are different inclinations, so you get, you know, information of, from each satellite when you you do the studies, you get something new. Between July 1983 and December 84, and again observation from both the cameras have been successfully used. Evaluation of geopotential coefficient from orbital resonances. So this is one of their strong, they were very, I think they were the, at that time, the strongest group in the world working on these kind of things. An orbit is resonant with respect to the geopotential harmonic coefficients of order M if the track over Earth repeats each day after M revolution. If M is equal to 15, so for example, the tracks are 24 degree apart. That means 360 degrees divided by 15, that is 24 degrees each time it will pass 24 degrees later. So on your longitude will be changing by 24 degrees apart in longitude, and perturbations due to harmonics of order 15 build up day by day. So they will see same place, you know, day by day. So that will certainly affect the orbital decay or orbital evolution of the satellite. This happens when the orbital period is approximately, during that period is around 96 minutes. When the orbit passes through a resonance very slowly as it contracts under the influence of air drag, because it another air drag again, it doesn't allow it to remain at 15th revolution all the time. Gradually 15 point something will come, because the orbit will reduce in size because of the drag. Analysis of the cumulative change in the orbital orbit provides the most accurate method of determining lumped geopotential coefficients of appropriate order. So they do. I have not worked in this area, so the deep details I do not know how do they do, but well, that is how they, when you read their paper, then they will say this has improved, that has improved, and they will say some of those things. Of course, I had used these papers for the getting the orbits, because to study our decay, because we were interested in seeing the orbital decay of the satellites. Each lumped harmonic is a linear sum of individual harmonic coefficients and gives one equation between the individual coefficient, which can therefore be evaluated if results are available for satellites of different inclinations. This was done last year for 15th order resonance using 35 orbits. That means 35 different inclinations they were having. And the results were published in 1987 in Planetary and Space Science. Most of their results are published in Planetary Space Science or in Royal Society of London. And these are the major publications which I have, because Planetary Space Science will deal with this kind of things more. The 16th order resonance, 16 revolutions. You see, 16 revolutions means the orbital period will reduce, which occurs when the average height of the satellite is usually between 200 and 250 kilometer, is exceptionally difficult to analyze because of the severe air drag. During that, the drag will be very high and the orbits will decay rapidly. It is essential to have satellites of low area by mass and very frequent accurate orbits. So you have to get, first thing, area by mass should be low, mass should be high, then only you will be, that decay will be slightly less. Otherwise, the decay will be very quick and you will remain in 16th order for a very small time. The satellite will decay and come to, burn and finish the life. Previously, only one such orbit has been successfully analyzed. Skylab was a very huge body. You might be remembering Skylab, those who are, I don't think everybody of you may be remembering. You may be very young also, some of you may not have been born also. In 86, so that time when Skylab was coming down, it was a very huge body, and there was a, I mean, its orbit even below 100 kilometer, or also it was taking a full revolution. So these people have done one analysis that time. In 1986, Skylab by DMC Walker in 1983. In 1986, four more orbits were successfully analyzed at 16th order resonance. A.N. Winterbottom and W.J. Bolton determined and analyzed the orbit of Intercosmos 10 rocket 19173882B in its last 15 days. King Halley and Walker analyzed 19171068 and these other three. All five analyses were of the orbital inclination and yielded five pairs of lumped harmonics over a wide range of inclinations. So they were different inclinations. From between 50 and 93. So they, at 16th order, they got these studies, because getting a satellite, getting good accurate orbits for that, all those things are, very difficult task. And then unless the orbits are accurate, nothing much can be said. From these lumped harmonics, D.G. King Halley and DMC Walker have determined individual coefficient of order 16 and degree 17, 19, and 21, and 23, and 25. Of these, the values of 17, 21, 19, and 21 have an average standard deviation equivalent to 2 centimeter in geoid height. So 2 centimeter in, only 2 centimeter in geoid height. This is a standard deviation. So that means we can say they were fairly accurate. The lumped harmonics have also been used to test existing comprehensive models of the gravity field. It appears that for order 16, there are deficiencies in these models, especially at high latitudes, when you need very high inclination orbits. As mentioned in the previous section, three other orbit determination at resonance are well advanced, though these were studying at that time. Later on, they might have been over. Now you see, this is upper atmosphere studies. From all these studies, they make very important, this analysis. The analysis of Intercosmos 10 rocket in its last 15 days by Ian Winterbottom and Bolton yielded two accurate values of atmospheric density scale height. See, this is another important parameter for the atmospheric drag, the density scale height, deduced from the decrease in perigee height, namely 27 plus minus 1 kilometer at 200 kilometer height for 1977 September and 24 September 24 to October 3 and 28 plus minus 1 kilometer at 190 kilometer height for October 3 to 7. So this is again, you know, these are also deduced from those studies. Analysis of decrease in inclination. See, the inclination also decreases. They study that thing. After removal of the effect of 16th order resonance gave an atmospheric rotation, they found out the atmospheric rotation also, rate of 0.9. See, we take an average value of for the last 20 minutes, for the full day, around one, that the atmosphere, that's an average value, 1.2 times faster than the rotational rate of Earth. But you see, 0.9 plus minus 0.06 is quite less only, revolution per day at a height of 200 kilometer for morning hours. This is, see, there is a difference between morning hours and evening hours also in the rotational rate of the atmosphere. And these also play a role in the orbital evolution of the orbital decay also. The corresponding wind speed also is 40 plus minus 24 meter per second east to west. So this speed also plays an important role, east to west and meridional, north to south. This south to north, these also play important role. So this is a, you know, complicated area in atmospheric drag, and probably that was one reason why my papers were published in the Royal Society of London, because working on atmospheric drag theories, probably those people felt that anything you work on this certainly will be useful to the people later. They will be able to, because this is an area where you cannot say, there are so many parameters which are uncertain, and anything improvement you make, so because my claim was there that this decay, analytical results are better than other analytical theories, so probably that was the one which probably gave me the advantage. RAE table of science, see, they are the only agency that from the beginning of since 1957, first October 1 Russian satellite launch, they are maintaining that table of satellites, and we were very much benefited, because we were having these tables in our center, and from there only data. See, we have to check the lifetime of satellites, check our programs whether working or not working and how good they are. So the data, some of the data, we need mass of the satellite, area, effective area of the satellites, and things like that. So they were maintaining this RAE table of satellites. They call it them RAE's table of satellites, in order to help in choosing orbits of geophysical studies. We have maintained since 1958 a table of Earth satellites in which all known satellites are listed with estimated and actual lifetime. Even rocket bodies also they put it. Once they are orbiting bodies, there is no difference between satellite and the rockets, because they are all orbiting bodies. Weights, dimensions, and other orbital details are all instrumented satellites and their associated rockets. Fragments are listed without these details. Tables at the end of 1982 was published by Macmillan Press in 1983 as the RAE table of Earth satellites, 1957 to 82. Very important document, because people who work on this think they need some data for testing their theories or numerical results or whatever they are working. And a supplement covering launch in the year 1983 to 86 was issued in the spring of 1987. This supplement has been added to the previous published volume, which has been fully updated at the end of 86. And the whole of this is published later in 87 as the RAE table of Earth satellites from 1957 to 86. It consists of an 18-page introduction, 893 pages of tables, and a 42-page index. You see, this is a huge, huge book, 893 and 18, and so it's almost nearing 1,000. Satellite lifetime prediction. We continue to predict this because they have to, you know, for each satellite, whatever body they in the table they put, they have to put a value, approximate value of their decay also. So lifetime also. So they are also they have been working. So we continue to predict the lifetimes of spacecrafts and rocket in orbit, chiefly for use in maintaining and updating the table of satellites. This task is increasing, is wondrous. Is a very, very, I saw today, this is a very very difficult task, you can say. Now and that, hundreds of satellites and rockets are moving in highly eccentric orbits, which usually require numerical integration sometime up to 20 to 30 years. That's why King Ali and his other associate, they developed a method for the life, orbital life of the high eccentric orbits also. The lifetimes of satellites in orbit of lower eccentricities are calculated by simple graphical methods. Recently, King Halley Walker, what earlier was discussed, have devised approximate method for assessing the effect of lifetime on the changes in upper atmospheric density during the sunspot cycle. Because it depends upon the sunspot. The 11 years solar cycle is there. That also plays, and day to night density variations also they play important role. So this also some graphical, it's a good report which I was, he has sent King Ali. I was in constant touch with Professor King Ali, and he sent me a lot of documents what he used to send. So that way I was quite lucky to be associated with him, and maybe it has motivated me to work in this area. And odd zonal harmonics have been brought together in a compendium of lifetime prediction methods, RAE technical report, this. I think this report was there, is there with me. So you can see biography, whatever they have done. Gooding, another important person, 3. And you see King Ali, how many years? In during 1 year, 1988, he retired. 40 years of service there. And then, but you see how many during just previous year, how many years contributed. And you can see the some of them are, this is a report. And you know, this is a planetary space science. This is again RAE report, and this is again, and these are all reports, and this is planetary space. You got these results, and this is proceedings. Because whenever they publish, they do a theory, then mostly they will publish in Royal Society. So this is proceedings of Royal Society. This paper also, he sent me. I am having that paper also. Improved theory of determinant changes caused by this. This is also in the. Caused by Meridian, improved theory of determining changes in orbital satellite caused by this. These are both are important papers. Just before retirement, he has published this. Later on also, he continued. He has, as I told last time, only in December, 25th December 2019 only, he has left this world. So he has contributed significantly to the thing. Now let me. This is the one which we developed an analytical approach using case elements to high eccentricity orbit prediction, including that. Here we have done density scale height variation also as it varies with altitude. So that effect also we included it. And we made this was a very accurate theory we have done. The citations are only 4 because unless people work, citations will not increase. And we are also not working now in this area much. So this is a one which we developed, and as we felt that this is useful for the for orbital decay of high eccentricity orbits. And we have done up to 1,000 revolutions. We have checked this. See, in aero capture and aero gravity assist are two important space flight approaches that can enhance several planetary missions. Aerobraking is the use of passes through a planet's atmosphere to slow down and lower altitude using friction created from flying through the atmosphere. Generally, the solar panels are used to provide the maximum drag in a symmetrical position so that control of the spacecraft can continue while it passes through the atmosphere. This is the thing, you know, that they make use of, because when you want to put, especially to say to Mars, when we go, so for example, we had gone once and we remained there because we had put around 400 and by 80,000 something, around nearly 400, 384 or 400. But supposing we had gone to little lower, the problem is with us at that time, the capability, whatever capability we had, we have made the best use of the capability. But next, another mission now, the ISRO is planning in near future, that will be also an orbital mission. But recently, now you have seen the last 3 days back, the Americans have already now the one more rover has been put on Mars, and the person who is doing controlling that is one of the important person is our one Indian origin lady. She did her PhD from MIT in aerospace. So what happens is this kind of thing, when we don't have enough power, we can go into a orbit. It was tried in one of the missions. I will show you. Mars Global Surveyor launched in November 96, reached Mars in September 1997, it entered a highly elliptic orbit. 260 kilometer is periapsis or periapsis, that is the minimum distance from the surface, and this is the farthest, 34,000 respectively. After performing a series of changes to lower the periapsis in its orbit at an altitude of 110 kilometer, they changed it to 110 kilometer. It used aerobraking technique. Aerobraking technique naturally for a period of 4 months to lower the apoapsis to nearly 450 kilometer. Because whenever the satellite will pass through the periapsis, the perigee or the nearest distance, then it will lose some energy and apogee it will not reach. So they use this. They use 4 months, but well, they do. At that time, that was the energy that is long time back. Now they have enough energy. NASA has enough resources for improving their things, and so they do not need all these things. But when we did, we whatever maximum we could do only put a one in orbital phase with a periapsis of 400 and apoapsis of the maximum distance of 80,000 kilometer. So they could make it. So this is where this kind of, you know, the orbital decay kind of studies can be useful if they are accurate. So this was there in the back of our mind, that this orbit, we put a lot of efforts, myself and Xavier, both of us put a lot of efforts to make this, and this was presented also in the the results were presented also by me in IAC that happened in Hyderabad in 2007. It was presented also, these results were, and later on we made them into research publications. So here we have taken the oblateness of the atmosphere after including variation density, scale, height with altitude. This also we included here, and oblateness of the atmosphere also we included in this, and we have used this. This was a free software available that time, all the expression required for the, because we are, it was a huge calculation, so we use Maxima software, which is a free computer algebra. Still it is available, the computer algebra system based on 1982 version of Maxima, written in Common Lisp and released under the general public. So this this one we utilized for all our studies. The free software available now, also it is available, and those who do not have access to other softwares, then they can use this. So here we went through a detailed calculations we carried out. How do we did it? We see, this is the drag, the atmospheric drag we define like this. Rho is the density, and in delta the other parameters, and this is the velocity vector. Okay, so this is the velocity vector, and the same following the same earlier these equations are the same what we have used earlier, and they are quite symmetrical, you know. See, one advantage when I saw this was that when we use this, these expressions are only related to V, this into V, and this relator is V by R. So that had something to do with the evaluation of the their accuracy. And you see this F0, F1, they look very symmetrical, you know. See this plus minus, this they look, and this they also look symmetrical. So these equations with the drag were quite useful. Now delta is, again, this is the drag coefficient, this is the mass of the satellite, and this is the effective area. Effective area is the area which the satellite experiences towards the direction of motion. And this F is also a parameter which is related to atmospheric rotation. F also must have been given. Maybe somewhere else, it may be there. So this is F is here. So this is here, you know, this is the rotational rate of atmosphere, what I am talking, you know. We take a value 1.2, but actually this has got daytime, morning time and evening time. That is what is recommended, that atmosphere average value we have taken. But if we want to, supposing we have been given different numbers, then we can even change that. This is the rotational rate of atmosphere about Earth's axis. So these are all the, and this is the velocity at perigee. So this is oblate exponential atmosphere. So this is all there. For this, King Haley's book, you know, was the standard, because yes, even if anybody has done, but he has documented it so well. So we took the atmospheric, this one. This is the density scale height H, and sigma here, the atmospheric that oblateness comes in epsilon. And now theta is the true anomaly, small omega is the argument of perigee. So now R minus sigma by H, this has been written in this form, and now we have Z is equal to beta AE. Beta is H, so AE by H, this parameter. A is semi-major axis, the big parameter, small e is eccentricity, and this value is now somewhere around, you know, 20-30, it varies with altitude. Now, so that this parameter, now this is our density is ready now. So we have taken this up to this parameter. Okay, now we have now changing now we because we want to we are, this is doing for the high eccentricity orbits, so you need to have another independent variable. This now we have got in terms of this, And the new parameter, earlier we use S, Z we have used. So that is defined cos E by Easterney. Cos E is equal to 1 minus lambda square by Z. So we have got this lambda as the new independent variable. But then again we change this Z by this equation. This it makes it little more convenient. S square is equal to Z into 1 minus E upon. These are all, you know, given there in the book as well as in the is paper. So we are following his papers, book, everything. And so with that we got. Now we expanded this up to 8th power in K. In terms of K is lambda by S. So lambda by S is the K. So Z was written in terms of S and lambda is written in terms that E is now independent variable is lambda. So this one, now this is the density rho. So once you obtain the density rho, now you are back, you go back to your equations where the density is involved. This density is involved here, this density. Now you have to push this density inside. You push it inside and then expand it, and then and the maxima has to come into play. So density, and the, you see the its coefficients also, because we have taken all the parameters up to whatever order it was required, we have included those things. So up to AR8, these are all the parameters. So you can see the complications of the terms. Now density scale height also we had density with the scale height variation. Now with the scale height variation also that expression was mu dh by dh. So how density scale height with altitude is changing, that parameter is mu, and that is also involved. Earlier we this parameter, this was not there, so that is also put it here. So now your density is now as a function of you have taken the oblateness of the atmosphere, and you have taken now the density scale height also, and you are going up to a fourth order terms. You have taken all up to fourth order terms. So now we need these expressions for them also. So they were also found out. I have not, I mean, they are not given here because it will take a lot of this thing. So they were not up to 8th power in K. They were input and then simplified. Now maximum power utilized, and we got into this form. Delta W 0 to that in integral is square root 2H, and like that we get, it's a long calculation, quite a huge calculation. So delta 1 is this and delta 2 is this. And again the same thing when square root 2z square root is greater than e for e greater than 0.2, the limit square root 2z in this may be replaced by infinity. So with the only error of this. This is the one approximation which we have to make to get the integrals. And then this becomes this function, g function. And g has got the recurrence relation. And this is also utilized. And we need this g0, g0, g1, g2, g3. From there we get these values. We need them. And after all the simplifications, etc., a lot of algebra involved, then we get this. This becomes simple. So this is change after one revolution. Change in energy and change in the state vector. These are 8 equations. And this is the, and their initial conditions only that we need to change. So this is one change in energy, and this is change in the state vector. So this. So numerical results also we carried out it more with detailed on a large variation of the involved orbital parameters we took. So this is the ballistic coefficient, mass by CD and effective area. And this normally this varies between 50 to 100 in most of the satellite cases. So we have taken a value, higher value, 50 value. We have, I mean, we have not taken we have taken 50 because our when we were checking some of the cases, they were coming of that kind. So 50 kg per meter square we have taken a value, and then the Earth's equatorial, these parameters we have. See, this value we have taken 1.2. This is the gravitational constant. This is 39 gravitational constant of Earth, 398600.8 kilometer cube second square. And SIRA 1972 mean atmospheric model we use to get the density and density scale height. We need to calculate these two. At the end of each revolution, we update density and density scale height from the, we know the altitude, and then we go to the SIRA mean atmosphere. But here we can do anything. We can do any other density model also we can use. That's, but just to check, you know, the results can be checked by any model. They won't change much, even if you use any other density model. So now I will show you the results. Tables are there. We have taken 175 kilometer, up to 1,000 kilometer we are gone. Percentage error, etc. We have calculated. I will show them in you. The figure. So this is their first table number one. You see what table one says is decrease in same weather axis and eccentricity and percentage error after 100 revolutions for orbit with initial perigee altitude of 180 kilometer and inclination 85. So we have taken a very low altitude and inclination, because normally errors will be more when inclination is high. So we have taken worst kind of case, and altitude also we have kept reasonably low, 180 kilometer. And now you can see there the this is the even actually we should have tested only from here, but because we have taken fourth order terms, so even it was working well even from here in itself. The you can see here the, if you see the percentage errors also you see, and from here onwards 0.3 onwards the errors are 0.1 0.0, like that it is here. And this area, this is which is of mostly when we use such theories, we use mostly from 0.6 to 0.8. So the theory was very accurate. This is numerical decay in 114.61, and we get 612 from this theory, 718 and 738, 839 and 309. So we got so accurate, you know, this is after 100 revolutions. Similarly in eccentricity, and you can see the percentage errors are almost matching in both. This is with mu, when there is the effect of scale height is not taken, and when scale height is taken, some error must increase. And that will increase also. You can see here, the numbers increase here. So even the worst case, it won't go. Scale-wise variation will not change more than this. It will be somewhere near to 0.1. So here also we have checked the all theories. And you can see here also the errors are very, 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 quite very, very less. We are able to see 504.439, 504.6. So after 100 revolution, only this much difference is coming. So what happens is numerical integration, you have to spend a lot of computer time. See, analytical may take 1% of the computer time of the numerical integration. If you take 100 seconds there, you take 1 second in analytical integration. So that's the advantage of the analytical. So this was a very accurate theory, which we did. So you have seen here, and you can see here now through the figures also. This is with the scale height. You can see some errors will increase when you go with the scale height increase. No scale height variation. When scale height variation is there, you can see the red one. And 180. When altitude is, when perigee is less, with the perigee we have chosen. This we have done for perigee. And inclination was 80. We have taken maximum inclination, 80. We are reasonably maximum higher side, and eccentricity 0.6 we have taken, and this is their perigee height increase from 175 to, this is 175 to 300. So we have checked it over perigee height. and eccentricity we have kept 0.6, and inclination we have kept the 80. You can see the kind of these are the differences between the numerical and the analytical. So over they are not so, they are very very less over 100 revolutions. This is a thing after 100 revolutions, and this is say percentage error. Now you can see percentage error also in some the same whatever the earlier graph we have seen. Percentage error also you can see the percentage error is only this. It varies from up to maximum less than 0.05% only it goes in terms of after this. And these all calculations are after 100 revolutions. So theory was, this is a very accurate theory, and if future we do not know, but all the details we have provided. If somebody is using, you can use it also. But as I told you, now the programming everything etc. is a little task, and this is again we have checked with eccentricity. See, we have changed the this eccentricity, we have changed from 0.5 to 0.8, and we have taken 200 kilometer altitude. That is the height only 200 kilometer and inclination 80. We kept 80 so that the worst case is scenario. Idea was to show that this is the maximum errors we can have. So difference between the semi-major accident and this, you can see so less somewhere. This is when, so this theory works, you know, quite well. Zero when somewhere in this area it works very well. They are less here, and similarly these are the errors in the same previous one, percentage error. Now here we have checked with inclination. You can see there the higher inclination, the errors were more. That's why we chose that higher inclination. Inclination because this is zero value. So the zero value somewhere around 50-60 degree inclination, the errors are less here. Difference in this is difference between both. So this is less only. Where difference is less means they are less only. So they are shown less. And as you go, there will be more. So this is with respect to inclination and 200 kilometer, and then eccentricity is 0.6. And all the time we have seen that when mu is higher, you will get little more. That is anyway understood, because you are taking another parameter, and then that parameter also will play a role. And this is the one which percentage error. So percentage error again zero is there here. So percentage error will be less somewhere around this, much less. And this is also 80 and after 100. These are all after 100 revolutions. So the orbit is calculated for 100 revolutions, and then they are all. And this is the one. What happened? This is okay. Yeah, this is the one you can see after 1000 revolution. This table, one, I think some suggestion was there from the referees, and I now vaguely remember. So our y-axis is useful to all the three. We are doing here. Decrease in kilometer. This is the decrease, analytical or theory. How much is the decrease has gone in? So you can say semi-major axis can decrease even up to 3000 kilometer. So and then here analytical minus numerical in meters. So that is in meters. So these numbers, there is no unit is written here. So now for this reading this, this will be in terms of meters. So after 1000 revolutions, after 1000 revolutions, so the difference can be 2000 meters or like that. So for this, and this is percentage error into 10,000. So the percentage error is 500 point something, then divided by 10,000, when you do that will be the only percentage error. So percentage error also is almost, you know, almost like a very almost very 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 non-linearity is almost negligible. There is a small one, but almost it looks like a linear. Non-linearity is almost, it's increasing very 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 slowly over here. Okay, so this took us a lot of efforts to push into this form. So you know, some of you who are those, when you are drawing your graphs etc., you can learn some lesson from this one. The same we have put it this, but then three things can be shown from this. This three graphs have been pushed into one, but very meticulously has been made. So this is the one, because this does not contain any unit, but here only we have written that analytical in kilometer. So when you read this, they will be read as kilometer. When we read this, then it is written in meters. And when we read this is anyway into 10. So percentage error. So into 10,000. So this is what we evaluated the theory. And the acknowledged authors are thankful to referees for their constructive comments and suggestions, which helped in bringing the paper to the present form. The authors are also grateful to editor-in-chief. He was a great big man, for his kind support and motivation. And then these are all the ones in appendix, the values which were calculated by Maxima. Some of these values, you see, some of the values have become quite large. And conclusion, anyway, as told you, a new theory we have developed, a new non-singular. See, this is a near non-singular theory. There are no singularities. For the motion of our satellite orbits, the air drag is developed for high eccentricity orbit in an oblate atmosphere with the variation of density, scale, height with altitude. Both the things we have taken. Only two of the nine equations are solved analytically to compute the state. This is another advantage of the case elements, that you are handling only two equations of the nine equations analytically. Others are anyway computer is doing. Due to symmetry in the equations of motion, the series expansion up to fourth power are generated in terms of an independent variable lambda, function of the eccentric anomaly at sea. The analytical solution are compared with numerical integration values up to 1000 revolutions are found to be very accurate over a wide range of eccentricity, perigee height and inclination. The theory will be very useful in the mission planning. See, these are all useful for mission planning. When supposing you want India is going on a orbit there, and we have gone into say 100 something by this thing, then we want to find out how much time it will take to come to a near circular or some particular apogee or periapsis. Then these kind of solutions will give an idea. And then that can be checked by numerical integration also, one or two cases. But then this gives in mission planning, they are useful for atmospheric breaking of the aero-assisted orbital transfer orbits. And these are the references which we have used by that time. So this is how. So this book of King Haley, this is the book, you know, which a famous book, D.G. King Haley, Satellite Orbits in Atmosphere Theory and Applications. Like Glaxo and this. Now, last two, three years back, we checked even it won't look so good, but as well, its cost was 21,000 rupees. So this is how this thing, today's lecture is.